So I might as well start with myself, Cheyenne Cheng, and I'm from OBC, Department of Pathobiology, and I've been involved with the Poultry Health Research Network over the last little while, and I'm very pleased to be here. And Dr. Bedecarrats is going to be giving a seminar on his research program. So Gregoy, you know what? I'm just going to leave you to last. So last but not least. So Bill, would you like to introduce yourself and say a couple of words about yourself?
Bill Scott Nicky, I worry about computing and information technology in our department here.
Hi, I'm Shai Barabut. I work for poultry meat processing. I sit in food science. I used to sit here, but they sent me away to food science.
Georgia Mason, Professor of Animal Welfare in this department.
Mr. Ross, I'm a graduate student in poultry welfare.
David Bevan from the Alvin Research Station of Fish Culture.
Corbin Bridges, I'm working with Rich in aquaculture as well.
Haley Bellevo, I'm an undergraduate student in animal biology.
Alexandra Hollander, assistant professor at the Animal Bioscience Department.
Ilka Böcke, I'm a research assistant with us.
Okay, so maybe we can go with you, Tina, and then. Yeah, there's nobody else in the back row, so why don't you introduce yourself, Tina?
Tina Wadowski, I'm a department professor in this department, animal biosciences, and I'm at Farmers of Canada and research here in Poultry Welfare.
And yourself?
Adriana, I work with Lighting with Dr. Bedecarrats.
Okay.
In animal biosciences.
I'm Charlene, I'm one of Gregoy's master's
students. I'm Brandy.
I'm Sarah,
I'm
one of Gregoy's undergrad
research
students.
I'm Lisa,
I'm a DVM
student.
I'm Al Dam, your provincial poultry specialist with the Ministry of Agriculture and Food over in pathobiology.
I'm Trevor Smith, I'm retired.
What do we want to be?
That's right.
David Hobson, I'm from the Catalyst Center, I play in the IP sandbox.
I'm Andre Quintero. I'm a visiting research from Brazil, from the University of São Paulo, and now I'm in the Dr. Sharif's lab.
Alex Iguar, PhD student with Dr. Cheyenne Sharif.
Tahan Shazadouz, postdoc researcher working with Dr. Sharif.
I'm Adriana, and I'm also a master's student with Dr. Sharif.
I'm Ravi Kulkarni. I'm working as the coordinator for the Poultry Health Research Network.
My name is Raja Kerry. I'm the new poultry nutrition professor. I just started a week ago, so new here. Still
welcome, Elijah.
Yeah, welcome.
And we had two new arrivals. you came late, but you know you were not unnoticed. So.
So hi everyone. I'm Lisa Pomerel. I'm doing my PhD with Dr. Alexandra Harlander.
Same thing, just a different. Excellent. Okay. So, Dr. Barbuda, I hope that this satisfied your curiosity about new faces around the table. Okay, so it is indeed with my great pleasure to introduce Gregoy Bedecarrats. I have to apologize. I'm sure that I'm butchering your last name, you know, in terms of my pronunciation or lack thereof, but you can correct me.
That's okay. So, no, you're not the first one. You're not going to be the last one.
So far, so good. So Gregoy was born and raised in France, and he completed his undergraduate work in France. Doesn't actually say exactly where it was, but I know that
University of Rennes.
Exactly. So his master's program was also at University of Rennes in France, and he studied the effect of prolactin on incubation behavior in turkey hens. He then came to Canada and started his PhD, I believe, with Dr. Zadvorny.
Yes.
Okay. Yeah. It wasn't actually here, but I remember from my recollection of things. And so he obtained his PhD degree from McGill University, and the thesis was focused on the biological significance of prolactin variants in turkeys. In 2003, he came to the University of Guelph after doing 3 years of postdoctoral fellowship at Harvard Medical School, where he studied the molecular mechanisms controlling reproduction in humans. He came to Guelph to become the poultry physiologist. So he and I were probably some of the founders of the so-called poultry program team, which was put together by the Poultry Industry Council. And you're looking at your poultry specialist around the table, Mr. Al Demp, who was also one of the members of the, and is still one of the members of the poultry program. So over the last 13 years, Gregoy's main research interests have been to improve the reproductive efficiency of domestic birds and to find a better balance between production parameters, health, welfare, and the environment. And more specifically, his work focuses on determining the mechanisms controlling reproduction in commercial avian species. As probably many of you are aware, on a practical side, he has spearheaded at the design, development, and validation of the new LED lighting system to be used by the poultry industry. Gregoy has been very active in teaching, both at the graduate level and also at the undergraduate level. He has been the mentor for the University of Guelph Poultry Club. And also, he's a very good academic citizen in the sense that some of us have been receiving emails from him inviting us to review papers because he's been the section editor for poultry science for the last...
almost 8 years. I'm completing my second cycle, yeah.
And as you know, he's also been involved in a lot of extension activities. So it is my great pleasure to turn the floor to you for your presentation. Thank you, Gregoy.
Thank you, Cheyenne. So first, I would like to welcome you all here, and I'm really happy to present because I've been presenting bits and pieces at various venues throughout the last, you know, maybe 10 years, and it's a good opportunity to put here everything back into perspective. And well, I'll be starting before I even thought about LED lighting. Okay, see where all the ideas came from, and then see how that idea then translated into filling up a need that was put forward by the industry. So just here, an oversimplified version of a chicken, if we look at the reproductive axis, like all vertebrates controlled by the hypothalamus, the equivalent of pituitary for some, for example, some fish may not have the exact well-defined structure, but the overall axis is the same with a neuroendocrine control at the level of the brain, the pituitary, here making an intermediate that will produce hormones targeting the gonads that will obviously produce the gametes, including sperm and eggs. And this works in a kind of a negative as well as positive loop control to maintain it in check. So a few players here that we'll be talking about a little bit more in detail at the level of the brain, here are the stimulatory peptide, gonadotrophin releasing hormone, and inhibitory peptide, gonadotrophin inhibitory hormone. So this actual design with a stimulatory and inhibitory peptide is fairly recent. GNIH was discovered in 2000, so it's already 16 years, but we can still say it's somehow recent. And what is happening, and I've been working for many, many years in trying to identify the various player in that at the level of the brain, what is happening is light can control the activation and the inhibition of the reproductive axis in chickens. We've all known that if you increase photoperiod, so you increase the number of the day length, the number of light hours, that will trigger sexual maturation in juvenile or in pullets, and as well in cockerels. And this is done so by directly stimulating the productions of GnRH. When I say directly, means that there is photoreceptors that we haven't identified yet that will then mediate it to the GnRH neuron, releasing its neurohormone in the portal vascular system, stimulating the pituitary, and then off you go, the chicken will mature and will start laying and producing sperm. However, another thing that I've been associated with the GnRH over the last 10 years is in fact GnRH is controlled by melatonin. And melatonin in birds, the same as in mammals, is considered to be the dark hormone or the hormone during dark time. So in essence, when you have more dark time, you've got more melatonin. That melatonin will in fact stimulate the inhibitory branch and will try to shut off reproduction. So which means if you are under short days photoperiod, then that bird will not be allowed to enter reproduction having a brake pedal through GNIH. And as you move now from short to long days, you lift the brake pedal and apply the accelerator pedal. So all of that came to mind that, in fact, in birds, melatonin is produced not only by the pineal gland there, like in mammals, but there's also local productions of melatonin at the level of the retina, and that melatonin actually travels through the optic nerve and can actually have local effect at the level of the hypothalamus here. And which raised the question to me, well, what is the role of the eye versus all those other photoreceptors, and what is the relative role of those? And this is really where I put a lot of effort in initially. This I won't spend too much time, it's just that as we were going along, we did a lot of cell signaling studies to look at actually how does GNIH and GnRH interfere with one another, and we saw that they can interact at the cell signaling level. So you have that brake pedal, accelerator pedal, and the integration happens at the cell level where the various amount of receptor present and the neuropeptide that stimulate this receptor will dictate what that cell is going to do. Should we produce gonadotrophin, LH, and FSH to stimulate the gonads, or should we not and wait for a better time? So this is kind of all, in a nutshell, a little bit the background that I worked on before even starting thinking about lighting. And here is just to summarize, that was in 2009 when we come up with our original model, took a long time to design, where we saw that at the level of the hypothalamus, we've got to switch from inhibition towards stimulation as we move from short days to long days. But at the same time, we also had a shift in the sensitivity of the pituitary gland that became more sensitive to stimulatory peptide as we move again from short days to long days. And all in all, leading here to the stimulation of the gonads and the various ear feedback mechanism. So this is just kind of a brief, quick overview of the scientific basis behind it. So what happened? At the same time when I was designing this model, I also brought a strain of genetically blind chicken from Michigan State University that they were about to terminate, and they were looking for a house, and I said, I'll take them for a while until I run out of money. And but while I was maintaining and breeding those birds, which develop a retinal degeneration very early on, like during the first few weeks of life, and sometimes they're actually blind at hatch, I say, well, look at that. That's a perfect model to look at the impact of the retina, because those guys, we can have homozygous defective birds that don't have a retina, and we don't have to go through removing the eyeball or various more invasive techniques. And what we noticed is using that line of blind chickens, the blind animals matured faster and earlier than the sighted. So that raised the questions, well, is the eye actually have an impact, maybe a negative impact rather than a stimulatory impact? And that kind of triggered my questioning about what is happening then with lighting. You know, we've got different photoreceptive organs that have a different impact on reproduction. Let's try to make sense of it all. So that's what brought me then to the spectrum lighting. At that stage, I was still not in the business of designing a light bulb, but I was just really wanted to look at those three main organs that are photoreceptive. Eye, no brainer, everybody that has an eye and a retina, this is where photoreceptors are located that will give you your visual information. And in this case, in the case of chickens, we've got four main photoreceptors: UV light, blue light, green light, and red light. So it's broader spectrum, visual spectrum than us human. And I'll come back to that a little bit later on. And the information travels to the optic, via the optic nerve to the brain. Pineal gland here has its own photoreceptors in chicken. They're called pinelopsin. And those pinopsin here are a kind of an hybrid photoreceptor between rhodopsin and greenopsin, and they seem to be more sensitive to the intensity of light than the spectrum of the light per se. So they can be activated by a broader light spectrum. Produces melatonin that will entrain the circadian rhythm of the bird and will also dictate some of the behavior associated with resting activities as well as feeding to a certain extent. And here, at the base of the brain, the hypothalamus, which is the big control center for all the metabolic and physiological process. And within the hypothalamus, there's also lots of photoreceptors that have been identified over the last 10 years. And those include UV photoreceptors, blue, green, red, and there's also a new one which is called ancient mammalian photoreceptors that have also been identified in there. So we've got the potential to have direct light stimulation, and the light penetrates tissue. Those electromagnetic waves, they can penetrate the skull, they can penetrate the brain tissue, and they can activate photoreceptor deep inside the body. So this concept that only the eye is the one that perceives light is totally wrong. We can perceive light much deeper. Having that in mind, now if we focus on the retina, and that's probably a little bit more practical for people who are used to use lighting in the barn, this is from Prescott, a very good paper from 1999, Prescott and Waters, that really put all of that together in terms of the sensitivity of the eye. And what we have here in black is the sensitivity, relative sensitivity of the human eye, the human retina. And those are the wavelength here moving from the UV all the way to the red and infrared. And as you can see, humans, we really see very well within that kind of peak in the green spectrum. If we deviate towards the red light, we don't see that red light as well. However, if you look in blue, here is a chicken reception. And as you can see in the chicken, they have more photoreceptors and they have a broader visual perception. So I'll come back to that probably later, but just to give you an idea, what does that mean? That means if you've got a green light, a chicken and ourselves see probably the same way. If you go under a more red light, the chicken will have about three times the sensitivity of us humans have. And why it is important is everybody up till now and still now are using lux and candle foot or foot candle as a unit to measure light intensity in the barn. Those measures are based on the human retina, which means what you measure is the human sensitivity. It's a relative intensity. It had nothing to do with the light itself, is how the human eye perceives that intensity. So when you use a lux meter, if you use a more towards the green spectrum, equivalent. But if you deviate, then that's not the same and maybe not the right tool. And here on the right panel, just to highlight a few different type of lighting system that we commonly use. Here, daylight, really broad. We've got pretty much all of the wavelengths that are part of the sun or daylight spectrum. Now, if we look in this case here, fluorescent, we can see the peak of fluorescent is towards the green-yellow. This is the majority, where the majority of the spectrum is delivered through those bulbs. Incandescent, the one that I've been used for so long, is a progressive increase moving with the majority of the light delivered towards the red spectrum and even the infrared spectrum. It's due to the physical or chemical and physical construction of the bulbs where you heat a tungsten filament and the emission will be towards the red. And here, if we have fluorescent, incandescent daylight, just again here to remind you, that's the visual acuity or the visual sensitivity of a chicken retina. Just to show that two lights, even if they may appear white to you, may be totally different from a chicken and may in fact interact or activate photoreceptors differently. All right, so having taken all that in mind, I said, all right, now we've got our supermodel, we've got our blind chicken, and since we don't know the mutation yet, and I'm still been begging for help from around the world, and everybody says, yes, we'll help, but nobody has done anything. So if anybody around there knows, okay, to help with, to identify this mutation, so it's a recessive mutation, which means by breeding that colony, we can obtain blind chicken, we can obtain sighted chicken from the same line, but with just by targeting, doing some breeding. Using that, we first decided to say, okay, perfect model, got money to buy a very expensive lighting system. Those were RGB, so red, green, blue, LED strip that were controlled, remotely controlled by a computer, about $700 a fixture of 2 feet long, so very expensive. We mounted those on top of battery cages. So we had green, red, and an equal amount of green, red, and blue. And we put sighted and blind birds in there, and then we kept them under an 8-hour photo period for 15 weeks, or from 15 weeks all the way to 20 weeks, and then we photostimulated with an abrupt transfer to 14 hours photo period. And we look at what happened. So what happened is we look at the age at first egg as a sexual maturation, indicator of sexual maturation, but we also look at estradiol. And why estradiol? Because as the ovary gets activated, small follicles will get recruited. And during that recruitment process, they will initially produce estradiol. And estradiol is going to be very important to stimulate the maturations of the reproductive tract, to stimulate the liver, to start producing lipids and proteins for the eggs, and as well to stimulate the calcium metabolism in preparation for laying. And this generally occurs a few weeks before the first egg is going to be laid around. So what did we observe? Well, if we look at the sexual maturation per age as first egg, what we observe is the birds under the green light were significantly delayed. So we failed to properly photostimulate those birds sighted or blind with green light. So it looks like that green light was lacking a stimulatory component. On the other end, red light and white light were relatively similar in terms of the age at first egg. So we did have a little enhancement, but no major difference, which kind of told us, well, maybe you need red light. You maybe don't need only red light, but you need a certain amount of red light. And if we looked at the actual hormone estradiol level, there we can really see the effect. Red light significantly stimulated the production of estradiol from the small follicles. Green light failed, and white light did its job, but was not as high in terms of estradiol as the level we observe under red light. And here is just to show that, in fact, here the blind birds were, for red and white, were kind of somehow underneath, but we could not reach statistical significance. So, as I tell my students, if you can't reach statistical significance, don't say it's there. Now, if we look at the overall production of those birds, what was very interesting is not only the green birds were delayed, they did not peak as high, and they dropped out of production earlier. So all in all, the birds, those smoky joes that were maintained under green light, significantly laid a lot less eggs than the ones that were under white or red light. And as a matter of fact, red, again, we did not reach significant. We did not have that many birds, but maybe red was a little bit better. Now, keep an eye that those curves, if you look, this is a strain that was never selected for egg production. Hence, we peak at around 80%, and those birds drop out of production by around 50 weeks of age, which is equivalent, let's say, to a layer strain of the, and you can correct me, Charlene, about the 1950s. Yep, all right. Now we also noticed under green light, very interesting thing is if we compare the blind versus the sighted actually drop harder and faster than the blind bird. So not only green light was unable to stimulate reproduction appropriately, it may even have an inhibitory effect on the reproductive axis via the retina. So we're all excited, getting all of those results. That was great, you know, and in this case, we showed what we wanted. One of the problems that happened is those $700 light fixtures started frying like popcorn in the barn. That was quite impressive. And it was all the electronic components, because, you know, an LED is basically a semiconductor and a bunch of little rheostat and controllers and electronic components on it. And what happens, those were frying and burning one after the other one. So we came to the conclusion that in a barn environment, you're subjected to fluctuation in powers. You're subjected to corrosive material, including ammonia, you're subjected to dust, and then you're also going to have to clean it. So that was great concept, but not really practical at that stage. So then what happened? Well, you know, as we all do, and thanks to the industry support, generally you're asked to then write a little article. Somebody writes a little article for you that gets published in a trade magazine. And in this case, it was in Canadian Poultry Magazine. And once that first article on the effect of light spectrum was published in the Canadian Poultry Magazine, I received tons and tons of calls. Tons of calls from producers or emails. They said, oh, I want to switch to LED. What should I do? Well, you know, they're not selling. I got a producer from Newfoundland who bought a truckload of 100 watt incandescent bulbs before they get phased out of the market. Imagine that, a truckload. So he knows he can have about 2 year supply of his 100 watt incandescent bulb. And Al can testify, it was just a free for all. Yeah,
still is,
because we had distributors that jumped in the market that never developed anything for the industry and said, you know what, my bulb that I developed for your kitchen, I'm going to rebox it, agricultural bulb, and then sell it to you. And we had a lot of nightmare issues. So anyhow, based on all that, what came down to is I had that farmer and his dad that came to see me and said, we want to try a new light, and that was Douglas Dijkstra. And at the same time, I had that old man, Eric Thies, who came to see me. He had a small little company, and he was kind of retired. It was a side business. And he said, well, you know what? I'm interested in that thing. Maybe we can find something together. And I said, yeah, well, if you know, I tell you how I see it, and you can do it, great. I'm not here to test your product. I'm here that you design a product based on what I think is best. So we worked together to just generate a prototype. And that's the prototype is here. You can pass it along. That was the first prototype that was designed here. And in this one here, we had 60% red, 20% green, 20% blue. The goal was it was fully dimmable, that we hoped that it could withstand a barn environment. And we wanted it initially to be low cost for easy retrofit. So having that particular bulbs, we then started to move on to commercial layers. And we still did it at RKL. So we started two trials, and they were almost started simultaneously. So even if one is called part two, the other part three, they run very close, because there is still a couple of questions. Now, we did our Smokey Joe studies in individual cages. And there were rumors that were spread across the industry that red light triggered cannibalism in chickens. And that was a sales rep that was saying that at every industry meeting for a couple of years, that if you put a red bulb, your birds are going to eat or kill one another. So what we did, we moved to on the floor and used some commercial layers. We used the Lohmann, and in this case, we went pure green, pure red, or the 60% red. And we photostimulated them more closer to at 18 weeks here with a 14 hours photo period. And then we did some room rotations to try to account for room effect. What happened? And this is when trouble started for me. What happened here is, in fact, those guys started to mature before photostimulation. So here is the day we photostimulated them. Those were already at 20%. They actually started laying, some of them, before 16 weeks of age, spontaneously under an 8-hour photo period. So that was kind of like a bummer, because how can we test our light when those guys already matured before we eventually turned the lights on? So nonetheless, we still went on with the trial, and what we observe is under the red light here, we did still see that kind of increase in estradiol. But again, we photostimulated them at 18 weeks, so it was even before photostimulation. So we kind of missed the mark on that one. What happened? Overall production, we did not observe any significant difference. Now look at that curve compared to the one with the Smokey Joes. Those guys, those commercial lines, they peaked at over 95%. So you've got a 5% room to play. they remained at peak production all the way until 65 weeks of age. Yeah, which means that those birds, they have nothing compared to our Smoky Joe. And that kind of triggered things saying, you know what, maybe my model that I spent 10 years developing, while the geneticists were breeding their layers, my model just went out of the door because they totally change up the genetic background of those birds and they change up the way they react to light. However, we did observe some really peculiar thing. And one thing was the time of flight. If you work with the industry, you know that you try to time your lights on and your lights off because normally eggs will be laid within 4 to 5 hours after the lights is turned on. And that's part of our, again, understanding and conceptual model about the control of ovulations where you have an open window that will allow the largest follicle preovulatory to get ovulated and then pass on. And if you miss that window of opportunity, the bird will skip a day and will have a pause day and will wait another day. What we observe is under green light, we had actually almost half of the eggs that were laid randomly during the nighttime. So we started to observe a desynchronization of the laying process. And that triggered another question for me. Say, well, we don't observe that with red light. We don't observe that with white light. So if you remove the red out of the equation and you leave green, those birds that are the Ferrari of the laying world, they'll still lay. But we lose that correlation between lights on, lights off, and the actual ovulatory process. So there is something going on with those birds where they get deregulated and desynchronized. Stress and behavior, for the behavior people, I don't have much data, but what I can say is we did not observe pretty much nothing really significant. Maybe the green had a little bit stimulated, a little bit more pecking at placement, but that was temporary, and then that was not observed afterwards. At the same time, we also had that other experiment that we did. We run it relatively in parallel, where in this case, we wanted to compare three light systems. And that was more this type to go more toward the practical side. Okay, let's say if we compare an incandescent, a compact fluorescent, and the LED, or the 60% LED light bulb, and as well compare energy consumption from the light bulb itself. And what we observe here, those birds were in individual cages, or easier to follow, same thing as the first one. They started laying before being photostimulated. They peaked at over 95%, and with the group of birds we had, we did not observe any drastic changes in production. But we observe something very peculiar. Now here is, again, keep in mind, this is the peak of estradiol, indicative of sexual maturation that again occurred before we stimulate them. But very interesting thing that we observe around that age, around 50 weeks of age. Normally estradiol should remain flat. And this is actually when you start depleting the recruited follicles that bird will progressively go out of flight and become photorefractory. What we observe with those Lohmann girls is you had almost a second spontaneous reactivation of the ovary and a second wave of recruitment of follicles. And if you look at those birds, they can lay. You look at the Lohmann guideline, you can keep them in lay for a year and a half and even more. And they will continue laying so extensively. Increase in estradiol, most likely coming from second wave of recruitment of follicles, that will also help the bird maintain an egg laying after almost a year into productions without totally disintegrating. Now, what we also observe is under the LED red light compared to incandescent and fluorescent, pardon, we had a slightly but significant over time a lower feed consumption and a slightly lower body weight. So we had, even if we did not observe any changes in egg production, that was still accompanied with a slight reduction in feed consumption. So if you look at how much you put in for how much you got out, in that particular case, you could save a little bit on the feed, even if you did not increase the production in that particular trial. So what did that tell us? Well, early sexual maturation was totally unanticipated. And in that particular case, I've been kind of plugging my model to try to feedback the body weight and the metabolic status as an actual other trigger, another cue beyond photoperiod for modern layers, that the metabolic status and the body weight may override the actual photoperiod as a cue for them to say you're ready to enter egg laying and enter production. Now, high peak here, we saw that sustained way longer than we anticipated. Those birds were very efficient. Now, in terms of the behavior, when you work with the Lohmann, you just can't get them to beat one another. They're so calm that you almost, they don't spontaneously will express a lot of the aggressive behavior that the older shaver lines used to do. In this case, they are so quiet that it's almost very difficult to stress those guys too much. And then here, the questions remained. We did not see significance on our Arkell trial. But if we move to a barn with 45,000 birds, even if we're talking of a 1% or 1.5% difference that may not be significant for our research station, when you transfer that in revenues in a 45,000 hen barn, that makes a big difference. So anyhow, here, just to go back to my sandbox here, that's the latest revision of the model. If you're interested, it should be actually, maybe actually published now in GCE, where we kind of plugged in as well some of the metabolic signal with potentially NPY and the leptin. I put an interrogation mark because it is still one of those controversial stories after a decade of research whether chickens have a functional leptin or not. Now, if we look at the electric consumption, well, it's no brainer. I mean, you've got a wattage rating on your bulb. This is what they consume, kilowatts per hour. So after this entire flock, what we noticed here, we had over a 90% energy savings when you switch to compact fluorescent, and that LED was slightly even more efficient than the compact fluorescent. Okay, that's all well and good. We did our part at Arkell, but do you remember that farmer who came to see me with his dad and said, all right, I am building a new barn. I read your article in the Canadian Poultry. I want the lights. And I told him, there's no lights. He said, well, I want them, and my birds are coming in April. So I talked to Eric Thies and said, do you think we can get that prototype? So you can step one step back on time to put in his barn. And we rushed in, got the prototypes, putting in his barn here. And here at Dijkstra's poultry farm in Thornton, Ontario, it has a 45,000 capacity. I think he runs generally around 42,000, 43,000 birds in there. Six rows, three tiers of enrichable colony cages. So when we started, they were not enriched, but now we followed them for several flocks, and now they moved on to fully enriched cages. We went with the birds that they had, Lohmann LSL Light, and we followed their directives because, you know, when you deal with a farm, you cannot tell them how to run the farm. You can tell them what you think is going to mess the results of your trial, but you just adjust to their practices. The only thing I added it to do was to put some dark outs on the vents, because they said if we're testing artificial lighting, we don't want any contamination from natural lighting that could mess things up. So put all the dark outs mounted on the vents, and let's go. First crop, as I said, I did not have funding at the time, because he came to see me in my office and said, I need the bulbs in 3 months. I said, well, I don't have the bulbs, I don't have funding. So, and I said, okay, let's boot the prototypes. And so we went there. What do they call that in the Brit land? Willy-nilly, no safety net, and put those bulbs in and follow that flock. And what happens here, they peaked at 96.2%. They were still at 90% productions when they were shipped out. The flock average here was 342.5 eggs over 365 days. And as I said, I didn't have a student, I didn't have anybody there, so it was just raw data coming from the grading stations. Here, no noticeable impact on egg quality from the report from the grading station. And then they realize they save 90% on their hydro bill at the end of the flock. Now, the other things that we notice is the light controller is a critical piece of equipment when you switch to LED lighting. LED bulbs are a miniature electronic board, and it talks to the controller. And if the two don't talk the same language, things are not going to work. And that's something it's hard to push on producers, saying you cannot just expect any controller to work with any light bulb. But they're always reluctant to invest in the controller. But you know what? If you want it to work, you will have to. Other thing, that first prototype that you can see, quickly we realized, not a good idea. The fins there started to be caked with dust. And so when the dust gets humid, and imagine that part here is called the heat sink. This is where the heat from the electronics is dissipated. It's a kind of an aluminum heat sink that allows the heat from the electronic component to be dissipated, which means that piece heats up, cool down, heats up, cool down. And what happens when you heat and you cool down things? It goes. So what was happening is we had a lot of gaps in the construction of the bulb. And as the bulb gets turned on and turned off, that dust that was caking on the outside found its way inside the bulb. Not good. And then when it came time to do a cleanup time, they all filled up with water. So we went back to the construction board. And in this case, that's what we came up with as a second prototype with a cast aluminum one piece silicone, screwed, glued, cap lens, and then we said, all right, we should be all good to go. So much thicker construction, and here I'll turn it on. That one is a 10 watt, and I'll pass it around here so you can see the difference in terms of the construction. And we were pretty sure that that was going to be the one. And at the same time, we also went through CSA certification, and I'll explain in a second why that was important. Okay, now we followed that bulb, that new bulb, for two flocks. What we observe, similar things. We picked, and actually the flock two picked at 99%. And we had another farm on the side that put those bulbs in, that used the shaver light, the white, which works for Grey Ridge, actually. Oh, Leanne's not here. They pick at 99.9%. So to tell you, that's not a lot of pose day. But overall here again, picked very high. They shipped out at, again, over 90% here. And this case here, we had 336 eggs for 350 days. So you can see the overall production. Now, why did I say CSA was important? Between flock one and flock two, the actual agency, the insurer, heard that he was doing something in his barn playing with those weird lights. And the insurance company came to the barn, looked at the bulb and said, they're not CSA approved. They said, not yet, we're doing it. Then the insurance say, if you don't take those bulbs out, I void your insurance contract. And those are the things when you go willy-nilly without safety nets, this is what happens, the situation that ends up. But thankfully, those bulbs did get CSA certified and we were able to get over it. Now, we also took some blood samples and measured a estradiol level. Not surprising, we missed kind of the first peak because those pullets started laying in the pullet barn, so they already were already maturing before they were moved to the adult barn. But again, we also again observed that increase in estradiol that occurred around 44, between 50 and 60 weeks of age. And again, we observed that for both flock one and two. So that's something which is actually induced birds, not at RKL, but it is genetically induced birds. And now I've got Charlene's going to be trying to figure out what it is eventually over the next couple years. We looked at the feed and growth as well. Feed consumption, the blue line represents the 100 grams. So according to Lohmann guidelines, they're supposed to eat between 105, 110 grams per day. That's what you would expect. So we were overall lower than the expectation from the farmers. And here, body weight were really similar between flock one and two. Now, for the producers, this is what matters. When we look at energy savings, First of all, if we did some calculations, if you compare incandescent versus a CFL or an LED at equivalent powers, here, now you can see the potential savings on a barn. 280 bulbs is the same barn as Douglas barn. And you can see just over a year, you can save over 8,000 in just in electricity saving, which means based on the price of the bulbs you should pay, they should pay for themselves solely on the electricity savings by in 1 year and a half. Now, in terms of production here, they were very satisfied. Overall, and this is something we have observed in multiple test farms now, overall, every time we are between 2 and 3% overall increase in egg production. So you can see that 3 eggs for every 100 eggs. When you've got 45,000 hens, you can make the calculation how many more dozens that you get per day. And I can tell you, his bulbs were paid within 3 months, just based on the increased revenue. So what happens to the bulbs though? We thought we had it nailed down, but when we actually here did the industrial cleaning with Jenny Mobile, which is a contracted cleaner for a lot of poultry barn, and I told them, make sure you test the bulb. So obviously, what did they do? They went with the pressure washer straight on the bulbs. Bulbs did not break. First day, nothing wrong. Second day, they cleaned the ceiling. And after they cleaned the ceiling, we started to see water in the bulb. The only piece that we did not look, that was off-the-shelf component of that bulb, was here, the part that you screw into the socket. And what was happening when we took it apart, there were actually some gap for the wires within that white piece there. And as they cleaned the ceiling, the water dripped down the pigtail, sat on the socket, and found its way through small little cracks and found its way in the bulb. So since then, we went to the drawing board and have now a one-piece end that has been redesigned to avoid any water infiltration. Okay, so here, if you're interested, this is where you can find the bulbs. The Energy Star was a problem because they only certify human products. So if you come with a spectrum which is outside of the Energy Star rating, they don't want to certify it. They don't care about energy consumptions, they just want to certify for humans. However, Manitoba has their own testing labs for their own programs because they got burned so many times, and we successfully passed and we qualify for the retrofit program. Now I'll try to wrap it up here with a few new things that have been ongoing. As you see, I got bugged down by those pullets that keep on laying early on. So, you know, I was talking to John Uthors at Burnbrae and said, all right, you know what, here, maybe we can do something. They wanted to test our lights. I say, well, you know what, why don't you guys there at Burnbrae take a pullet barn and test green versus red and then move all those birds into a red light for layers. And that's what we did. Well, that they did. I kind of piggyback on their project. And John is very good at that. He's got lots of ideas. So what we had, an old barn, pullet barn, subdivided into four quadrants, two floors, two on the top, two on the bottom. And they were kind of isolated with tarp, black tarp. And we ended up having a green room on top, a green room on the bottom, or green quadrant in the bottom. It's one barn. And so on, and a red and on top and a red on the bottom. Now, because it was Burnbrae and they were afraid that, you know, there's this scare, the industry is scared that if you don't blast light with chicks, they're all gonna die of starvation. Okay, and they're still scared about that. You know, so they say, oh no, let's wait till the critical period is over, let's use our good old incandescent bulb to blast intensity during the first 3 weeks. I say, okay, fine. And then we turn the lighting at 3 weeks of age. And then on the adults, at 17 weeks of age, they were all moved to one single adult barn that is split with a wire partition in the middle. And the birds that were raised on the green light were put on one side, the birds that were raised on the red light were then put on the other side of the same barn, and we'll look at what happened. Body weight, absolutely no difference. And why would I expect so? Because on the broiler world, there has been a lot of studies showing that green lights stimulate the body growth of the broilers earlier on and stimulate the gut development and the production of mucins. So we were like, maybe, but it doesn't look, it's the same for layer. And again, a broiler chicken, a broiler chick, it's totally different from a layer chick. So in our case, no impact on the light on body growth. We looked at multiple organs and bones. We did not see any difference during the growing phase. Now, what we did observe, though, on when we moved those birds to the adult barn, is in fact the ones that were raised under green light were behind in terms of egg production. And their eggs were actually as well smaller. So you had a lot more peewee eggs with the ones that were under the green light versus the one that was that were reared under the red light, which again support our hypothesis that the red lights helps stimulate the production of estradiol and stimulate the recruitment and the growth of those follicles in the ovary. So those were brown, Lohmann brown, and they peaked about 90%. So the reds, the one under raised under red light, initially had a head start. Then they kind of mingled together. And towards the end here, we're already starting to see a slight deviation. But whether it's significant or not, it's still ongoing, and we'll see how it turns out at the end, number of eggs produced per hen. Now, the last one I'm going to talk, and I know I'm always running way over time, so that's promised as the last one. Adriana worked on another project that with Martin Zudoff in Alberta. His thing is developing a precision feeding system, which is the birds have an RFID, they get into a little feeding station, they are weighed in real time, and then they get delivered a meal depending if they need it or not based on the extrapolation of their weight curve. Problem, to be practical in the industry, you need to be able to feed sufficient number of birds at once. And that doesn't work, you need tons and tons of feeding stations. So the rationale was, what about if we have the restaurant open 24 hours a day? Could that allow more bird to use this feeding station? I say, well, that's great, but you have to be careful, because if you use light 24 hours a day, your breeders, your broiler breeders are not gonna breed. So we decided to try, here in this case, two main light on the main barn, 60% red, 60% green, and then we installed supplemental lights, small LED lights on the bell feeders. And making sure that, and correct me if I'm wrong, I think the low intensity was one lux, 1 meter away from the feeder. So very low intensity, and we tried 2 intensity, 1 and 10. And we had different colors LEDs on the feeders to see what is the combination do. And to make a long story short, which is still ongoing, Adriana is analyzing the data here. If we looked daytime light or the main lighting, what we observe in terms of egg production is the birds, irrelevant of the supplemental light, the birds that were under the red light significantly had an increase or earlier production, again in broiler breeders, than the one that were under the main green light. But what was really cool is when we look at the effect of the actual supplemental light. If you supplement with blue or green light on your feeder, whether it is 1 lux or 10 lux, it did not impact anything compared to controls. If you had a tiny little bit of red light on your feeder and you supplement with a little bit of red light for 24 hours, that turned the system off. Which means that that red light, yes, it's great to stimulate, but what happens is if you stimulate, overstimulate, you desensitize. And what is showing here is like just that small little supplemental red light put on the feeder, if it's on 24 hours a day, was able to desensitize the reproductive active axis and prevents the egg laying to occur. So that tells us, for Martin, I told him, well, in your precision feeding station, green, maybe blue, but please avoid red at all costs, because you're going to mess your birds up before they start laying. All right, so I'm a little bit over time. Besides that, my usual thank you slide. Alex and Eric Chess from Chess Electrical. Alex took over his father when his father died while we were going through the project. Same thing, Douglas and Leo. Doug's father also died during the last, during the, no, it's nothing to do with me. So it's unfortunate, you know. And all that, just with the red light, you know, actually speaking of which, that's one of the thing that has come up is there is a warning, pure red light can trigger epileptic events in humans. So then there's also the human safety side that I did not have time to discuss in terms of bond worker. All the students, Mikaela, who did a lot of those works as part of her master's, Brandy, who is there, Adriana, who is also there, Charlene, who is also there, and all the other students, including Kayo, Andrew, Sarah, Basil, and a whole bunch of other students that got involved throughout the years. Of course, all the people who gave money. No, there is no grief layer in there. Oh, I had to. Crack one. Okay, and I'll finish it up here just to let you know that I'm supposed to be on sabbatical right now because I'm organizing a meeting in October of this year. So there will be more announcement and requests for help and assistance as we go through. We are in the process of finalizing the actual scientific content of it. And as I said, if we can have potentially a symposium with coming from Guelph beyond myself, that would be great as well. Anyhow, I'll keep it, try to keep it here, and hopefully there's time for questions. Thank you for your patience.
Thanks very much. Very interesting, very captivating. So I'm sure that there are lots of questions, but maybe, you know, we can limit that to 5 minutes or so. Any questions for Gregoy? Yes, please.
You did a great job explaining how humans are kind of
yes. Exactly. So that's a very good question. That's something we've been very cautious about when submitting, for example, the research results. Is that, well, first of all, there hasn't been a direct specific photoreceptors that had been pointed out saying you are the culprit. So we cannot say necessarily it's red. And then, yes, it could be the energy. Is it the energy level which is important more so than the spectrum? And that's always, you know, based on the data, I cannot say 100% this is just the red light, or is it just because the red light penetrates better because it has more energy than a green light. Now, I will have to really go like design a trial to test that as well. And hopefully you can find some engineers to design an app, a chicken lux app, so we get away with that stupid candle food light.
Yeah, I would have a question. Thank you very much for your excellent presentation. Do we really know what does it mean for the animal caretakers to work under red light conditions? And do you think that society will accept that we keep birds under these lighting conditions in the future?
So a couple of things. If it was just to me, I would have gone with 100% red light bulbs, way cheaper, easier to do. So why did we go with 20% green, 20% blue? That's in part to answer one of your questions. Because I'm talking to Tina, one thing that came up is says, well, if you go 100% monochromatic, the first thing that's gonna come is you're depriving birds from seeing within a certain range. So by still providing a more complete spectrum, we're not depriving them. It's not that they were under 100% red. So hopefully that will help a little bit. Now, consumer perception, it all depends who you talk to and who they talk to, okay, to see the real effect. Regarding humans, and that's why we really wanted to get into commercial barns and have the workers and looking at their feedback. And the feedback we had is, sometimes it takes a few, let's say 30 seconds of accommodation if you move from one, let's say a bright environment into a red room. But we haven't heard anything saying that it made me sick, it may give me headache, or it made me dizzy or whatever. Most we heard was, it's weird at first, but you just need a little bit of accommodation. I don't know if that fully answered your question. So yes, partly answered, but not fully. There's obviously things that I don't have control over. Yeah.
Tina?
I'm really interested in your desynchronization of colors in
yes.
green. Laying in the dark?
Yes.
What else causes laying in the dark? Do we know? I just sent somebody your email and I just asked me from Alberta, I'm farmers of Alberta. because they ever produce series laying in the dark. And my impression, or I thought that it was had to do with the mismatch between lights on in the pullet house versus the layer house and how quickly you increase photostimulate the birds.
That can happen, but then generally they're very plastic. The chickens are very plastic, and they will compensate for that within a couple of weeks. So they will fix themselves eventually, because the physiological control, according to HS model, was that open window. Now it's known that if, for example, you decide to suddenly switch the time lights are on by 4 or 5 hours, yes, you're going to have a few random laying in the dark, but eventually they will all resynchronize to the new photo period. So it should adjust over time. Now here, what causes that? I think there are two things. Green light, maybe the lack of red light is the lack of the trigger. But I think those commercial birds that lay peak at over 95%, this almost, there is an egg on the line every single time. And then it looks like it's almost like blocking that ovulation just doesn't happen. It's almost like the ovulation is there to go and it's gonna go through no matter what, because there's another one just behind it. But again, that's an extrapolation. I don't know, and that's really what we want to test as well with Charlene, is to see what is going on with those highly producing birds. You know, it's like, it's such a thin, thin, you know, rope that you're walking on between, you know, having double egg yolks or having some, you know, like double ovulations when you end up with a soft shell and an overcalcified shell. So they're really walking a very thin, thin line, I think, with those birds. And that just be an aberration, and an aberration that we could easily fall into if we move a little bit further into that selection process.
So do you think we should match the spectrum of the polar fire in the layer, change lights dramatically?
I am hoping, and that's what I wanted to achieve with the trial at Burn Bray, saying, okay, is there a benefit in growing the pellets under green light? Maybe you can slow them down in terms of production and then give them a boost with red light when you transfer them. But we did not see any major impact, you know, on the pullet growth. So I would be tempted to just go straight with a more reddish light from the start. It's going to be better, most likely better for the production later on. And if you look, interestingly, a lot of the combi cage, I think, which one is that? Is it Selmat? That has these mounted lights that they got from Al's technology. Is it, Al? Is it Selmat?
Yeah, well, yeah, once.
The hardwired one,
yeah.
They are the red light that they hardwired in there.
Red in it, or?
It is, well, the one that comes with the cage, with the combi cage, and I think it's the Selmat.
Yeah.
It's farm automatic. I would argue that's what
you're. No, because you've got the tube light. Those ones are hardwired lights that are mounted inside the cage. And I know at Burnbury they hate those because they have to dismount them every time they do a cleanup. But I think those were also the red light from Mount's innovation.
Well, it's amazing that you said it was the Wild West out there for a while in terms of what was being sold as LED lights. Like everything and anything was being put on the market.
Yeah.
And one year in Atlanta there was 4 LED light producers or sellers, and then the next year there was 20. And then...
Yeah.
And they all claim that they work with you.
No, there's a... you're right, that's true. You know, another thing, Tina, and I did not have time to talk about it, another thing that I'm really interested in the future is looking at is there's been some effect of lighting, not only photo period, but wavelength in the development of the embryo up until the chick. And I think there is a good potential for good studies to see if you can prepare the chick for a better fit. Yeah, Greg Archer did one study, but you know there's also a whole bunch of studies that were done in the spectrum and looking at the actual cellular response in the embryo to look at the spectrum on it. Yeah.
I think what is important that would be interesting to look at is hens' ability to negotiate, their willingness to jump between perches, their ability to distinguish their environment based on the different lights to ensure that they're not crashing more or having more difficulty seeing one spectrum versus the other.
That's
pretty critical.
Yeah, that's a good point. The thing is, we haven't had a chance to test them in a true aviary system.
We can do it. Let's
do it. Yeah, all right. Yeah, because that's the thing. Again, you know, how do they... we haven't noticed any major impact on the activity level overall of
but
the hands.
But
yeah.
Exactly.
On the yeah.
Floor, you're not going to see it.
Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. Yeah.
Well, Gregoy, I have to really thank you for creating such a good forum for conversations. And I hate to interrupt you, but I think some people have to go to classes, some have teaching responsibilities. So I know that you're doing your sabbatical, so I'm
yes.
also double thankful to come out of your sabbatical and do such a wonderful presentation. Would you have a few minutes after the?
Absolutely. Yeah.
So
yeah, no,
I have some questions, and I know that Bahram, you have a question, so I'm sure that Gregoy is going to be more than happy to entertain
yeah.
those questions. So please join me in thanking him for the wonderful seminar.
You're welcome. Thank you.